Happy Friday to all you Wakandans and Wakandettes out there. It's a sunny afternoon here in LA, and it's Black History Month, and you're here on Bruh Red Bull Radio, and I'm Zack Fox, presented by Awful Records. Being that it's Black History Month, the playlist today is very specially curated to my own nostalgia growing up with a black mom, cookouts, getting my ass whooped, all types of stuff that's indicative of just black youth and love and culture. Not a lot of rap on the playlist today. Kind of kept it a little bit PG-13 for you guys. And also, special treat, who better to have on a Black History Month episode of a radio show than the crustiest person I know, who also knows the most about music that I know, Thundercat himself.
I mean, I don't know shit, man. It's still Black History Month?
It's still, we got a little bit more to go. Just a little bit.
I'm celebrating by sitting by myself. It's just genuinely hot. We at the house really angry.
Have you been excited about this Black History Month? Have you done a lot of things to?
I don't know, man. Like, you know, niggas really think they from Wakanda. Like, that's not a real place. Like, you could actually help Africa, but
niggas like, I'm leaving. You like,
okay, Wakanda don't exist.
We'll be back.
Like when it actually comes to helping Africa, I'm like, no. But Wakanda, like, what? Like, what?
It really, I mean, it's like a beautiful thing to watch, because we finally get to do the thing that we've been irritated that white people are doing for decades now. Like, yeah, like, it's all, you know, it's always that motherfucker, like, oh, we're gonna open a Star Wars themed strip club, or like,
you're like, what?
Then you're like, that's whack. And now we have that, and it's like,
we have joined.
Nigga, I'm wearing a dashiki every day.
Yeah, like, what?
You're like, and everybody's about to be really confused about it, but like, the fact that, like, before I was a little bit protective, because, I mean, we're both like comic book fans, like, hardcore, so I was a little bit protective of it, where I'm like, nigga, you listen to Bryce Attila, you don't like Marvel Comics.
Marvel Comics.
But at the same time, I'm like, we need that. That's the inclusiveness that we need, where everybody's like.
Yeah, it's a bit of a double-edged sword, man. It was like, I mean, I think the one thing that I wanted to throw a shoot is this motherfucker, I saw a picture. This motherfucker showed up to Black Panther wearing the dad from a Coming to America shoot. I was like, how in your mind did you put these two together? It's just, it's like autism. Like, what are you doing?
You show up to a Star Trek convention with like a Power Rangers suit on. Yeah. Like,
I was like, what
I'm
is this?
I'm trying anything.
I was like, it's just black. And so because it's black, it's just it.
Wow. Well, what a beautiful month to be fucking up. On that note, let's go ahead and get to some music. I think we're going to start off. I'm going to start off with a little message for you guys to motivate you and get you started today. And then we're going to get into some Jadakiss. And we're going to get this shit popping, all right? Red Bull Radio. Thundercat, Zack Fox, this is Bruh.
I'm hurt.
We'll be back.
Weak, nigga.
And we're back. Red Bull Radio, this is Bruh. I'm Zack Fox once again. It's Friday. It's Black History Month. I'm here with Thundercat. You're like never not doing shows anymore.
Yeah. I mean, you know, well, that's a good thing, I think, you know, for the most part. But yeah. I'd just be like, it's one or the other. It's recording or touring.
Yeah.
So it's like, other than that, it's like, it turns into a black hole of like, just real weird.
All the shit happening at the same time.
Real life start catching up.
Yeah.
You just be like, I can't handle this.
I was talking to someone the other day about like this weird like intersection that you possess right now in music and in pop culture that I don't think a lot of people really notice. Like it's really easy for, you know, people who are fans of different kind of music to like one artist, but when you have someone who's like you, where it's like you're at this intersection where I, being on tour with you, the people in the crowd would be like a old, like crusty, the most stuffiest jazz fan, yeah. white man from Portland with yeah. like long white hair, and yeah. right next to him a kid who like looks know, like he was just at like
Lil Pump's concert.
A Lil Pump concert. And how, like, coming from your music family, which is like everybody in your family plays music, how did that specific thing happen? Where was that like factor?
Man. I don't know, man. I really don't know. It freaked me out to see it happen too. You know, it's like, you know, a lot. One thing that did freak me out a lot was like a lot of. First, there was the part where there was a lot of kids there. Mm. You know, it would be like, whoa. You know, it's like, like, you know, I'm like, what am I saying right now? Mm-hmm. Like, you know, but I don't know. It just comes from, I think specifically the part we're playing is like the, I don't know. I guess the forefront of what I do. Mm. So it's like the reality is all, you know. All of it, you know, I guess all jokes aside, it's one of those things that's like, I don't know, I just have always wanted to do something that was just different, mm-hmm. you know, and I never, there was a time where I could even say I wouldn't even have told you that I was going to put out an album. Mm-hmm. It was not a thing that was like, and this is the final part of the, you know, it's like, mm-hmm. it wasn't a thing like that for me. It would be like, I just wanted to be involved with things that would push stuff along, mm-hmm. as compared to just like going with whatever's going on,
going with the phone,
you know, like yeah. everything from, and like having friends that would fall victim to or go over and above or fall victim to mm-hmm. that weird line. Mm-hmm. I just kind of wanted to see, I feel like personally I would try to see myself through those things, because mm-hmm. there'd be moments I'd be involved with other, you know, things that were just kind of like anything from ultra successful to just getting ran in the ground. Mm. It's just, but part of my mindset was always like knowing that there was guys like Frank Zappa and Jaco and Herbie and these cats that have spanned the decades, and be like, well, how, what are they, you know, like, what are they doing that's, and it's like, oh, it's just a bit of honesty and sincerity in the music, right. you know, as compared to this.
Do you like, feel like that's just like, I feel like it always comes down to that with anything, any like art form, mm-hmm. and you know, because we were talking about last night, the intersection isn't just that like Lil Uzi fans like you and jazz fans like you, it's also comedians, like really big comedians that we all grew up on. We yeah. were, me and you were just talking the other night about, you know, it's super cool how like Chris Rock opens the special with yeah. your song, and to the naked eye that kind of just seems like, you know, a superficial, like, oh, this is a tight ass song to put in front of the special, but then you hear what he's talking about.
Yeah, and the correlation really exists.
And you're like, oh, he really was listening to the music.
Yeah, yeah, he definitely let me know that too. I got a chance to meet him last night in person, and it was like, it was great, because even with that stand up, man, like, that was impeccable. Mm. It was like, it just, it's a reason why these cats, and I love it, because it's like, it's, they still do the thing, they say the stuff that everybody's scared to say, mm-hmm. right now, and it just be like with no sweat, you know. But for me, the comedy and the music, the correlation between the two is really important, mm-hmm. you know. There's like all these different sayings that go with it, you know, like, you know, you know, the truth being told in jest and all kinds of stuff like that. But there's, I think that it's they're kind of like reflections of that same mirror that the stuff exists in, I think, you know, where it's like, well, he got up there and started talking about his, you know, he's been married for 16 years and getting, and like, he puts that out there.
Yeah.
And it's like, when you really, when it's like, it's all funny when he's using it as material, but then like, when you really see,
look in his eyes,
you go like, no, this is really him. He's not like trying to like, he's not trying to make some shit up for you to just like go, oh, cool, that was kind of funny. It's like, nah, like, he gets that honesty thing about it, I think, and I think with comedians, like, the better comedian you are, the more honest you are, I think, you know. There's nothing else, I think, other than that, and when it comes to it, especially with the stand up scene, the guys do that. But it's like, I don't know, there's I don't know, I mean, and for me on the other side with the music, I feel like there would be moments where I would find that bit of comedy in doing the stuff too, because it's like, like I said again, you know, it's like, you know, a lot of your heroes, like, you know, or a lot of the cats that we always see, is like this big thing of not being able to, it's like a shroud it's under, where it's like, it's supposed to be this reverend, like, you know, I've spent 30 years playing my instrument and take me serious. It's like, nobody gives a shit about bro, like,
yeah,
you know, I mean, like, seriously, like, yeah. I mean, if some of the, you know, like Beethoven, if they could have seen what was going to happen to pop music,
they would just, like, smash everything.
They would have, like, given up.
Just stop. Like, just
what do you think if, like, Beethoven would have met, like, Lil Pump? Like, it just, in any, like, what would happen?
Franz Schubert, like, seeing Triple X like, oh, my God, no.
It is, like, so it's just this thing. I mean, it's, like, everything and nothing at once, I think. And it's, like, you know, and you can't help but, you know, it's like, it's always like this weird wire it exists on anyway. I think pop culture is a thing that it causes it to be on this tightrope. Mm-hmm. But the reality is it doesn't exist on a tightrope.
Yeah.
You know, a tightrope. It exists and it's just a well you draw from, you know. And I don't know. I think that going back to what you were saying about, like, the kids and the older dudes there, it's one of those things where I think that's just, I don't know. I feel like it's hard to look at it like that. It's just kind of like, you know, it's just one thing that it does do to me, though. It makes me feel my age. Makes me go like, whoa.
Yeah.
Like, what have I been doing this whole time? It's like my toenails are all long and it's crushed in my eyes. Like, you know, I'm just like, what? It's like every now and again somebody has to, like, get the crust out of my
put some lotion on for you.
Yeah, like don't you walk out of this house without no
really ashy as fuck. On that note, let's get into more music and we'll be back on Red Bull Radio. This is bro Thundercat. Let's listen to some Diana Ross, The Boss. My mom used to play this song after she would beat me. No, I'm kidding. I love you, Mom. I love you. We'll be back. And we're back once again. You just listened to The Boss by Diana Ross, Reach Out by George Duke, and Just to Brighten Your Day, Optimistic by Sounds of Blackness. We talk a lot about collaboration because you definitely have really specific ideas on how collaboration works and where you draw the line between, okay, you just want me to play on some shit, or you really want me to be at the creative epicenter of what's going on. So I know that you see a lot of collaborations happen. You see a lot of people work together and you're like, this is crusty. this works. So I wanted to shoot some ideas your way. And it's basically collab or not. All right. So would these people make magic together or would it be a flop? Okay, so the first one's we've already kind of seen it in a Gap commercial. Oh, but Future and Cher.
Oh man, that just sounds like a photo. It sounds like a photo, like, sounds about like the same photo as Haji and Nelly Furtado. that's the first thing that comes to mind.
Absurd.
Yeah, like, yeah, I don't know, man. Like, I mean, Cher's kind of raw, you know. I mean, like, real talk, like,
yeah,
you know, she'd be able to keep up, but I don't know, man. Future got some dark shit at the bottom of what he's doing that he don't deal with. So I don't know where it would meet.
Yeah, it would be like the most spiritually happy but depressed shit ever. Like,
it's like meeting Akuma in real life from Street Fighter.
Do you believe in lean after learning?
Exactly.
Okay. Next one is someone that you've collaborated with in many times, both in music and in genitals, but and also one of my favorite rappers. So I wanted to see what you would think if they would make fire together, if it would be bad. Erykah Badu and Young Thug.
Well, it's levels.
Yeah,
it's levels.
It could go.
I feel like Erykah could definitely, you know, she it would be that. No, that'd actually probably be fire. Mm-hmm. Be honest, that, you know, that wouldn't be a.
It's not even too far fetched. She's worked with Drum. She's worked with.
Yeah. you know, she's about it. You know, like she gets it. She's there with it. So it's like, it wouldn't be far fetched, but it'd be funny seeing like Future creep up to the line. Like there's like this, like this ongoing joke of like, you can't look Erica in the eyes. Yeah. Like, it's just this thing. It's like Prince. It's just one of the things where like I see people do it all the time. As soon as they see it, they just like freak out and trying to see like Young Thug.
Like, I think like my grill fell out of my mouth or something when I met Erica. I was just sound like two forks popping together or something. Like, you're like, oh my god, what am I doing? All right, moving on. Migos and Arcade Fire.
What would the song be about, bro? What the fuck would the song be about?
I don't know.
Love, like, no.
Childhood nostalgia in the bando, like, beautiful, like, sweeping vocals.
Yeah, like, and then, like, a bunch of, ad libs. It's like, You got a button that go,
It's like Where the Wild Things Are.
I can't even.
Meets hood fights. I don't know.
It's like Hood Brawls 1 through. Yeah, like.
One more. We'll do one more. Charlie Wilson. It's Slipknot. All right, and on that note, we're going to go to break. Listen to some music, guys. Going to listen to some... I'm an idiot. Going to get into some Leon Ware. R.I.P. to the god Leon Ware.
Slipknot. My favorite Slipknot song is actually People Equal Shit. And it had, like, Charlie just, like...
Shabba-dabba-dwee-dee-dwee.
Shining. The video, it's like real shiny. It's a real shiny nigga with some niggas throwing doo-doo at each other. He just real shiny.
We'll be back. All right, Red Bull Radio. This is Bruh. I'm here with Thundercat. We're going to listen to some more beautiful black music and be inspired. We're about to move to Wakanda. All right.
What we'll the fuck is Wakanda, bruh?
Red Bull Radio.
All right. And we're back. We just listened to Leon Ware, Rockin' You Eternally.
Man.
Jill Scott, Golden.
That's
what yeah.
Golden,
not just
shower.
Yeah,
Golden.
Shout out.
Shower.
Yep. Yeah. and then we finished that little break with All I Do by Stevie Wonder, because you told me.
Yeah. Bro.
So to recap, Thunder just went to. What was it? A release party for Chris Rock special?
Well, it was a celebration for its release. Yeah.
Yeah, and Stevie's there, and I think from what you're telling me, we might have our next Quincy Jones-esque person in the black community who
nuclear meltdown,
who just melts down, and who's like, you know what? I don't give a fuck no more. So tell me again, what?
Stevie about
saw.
That life, bro. Stevie, I think it started, man, only thing I can say is I think it started back with the, I can't remember the event. I can't remember the event, man, but it was something along the lines of, it had to be I don't know if it was like a charity event or something that, but it involved the group King and Pharrell opening for him. And I don't know if it was that right after Colin Kaepernick or something happened. But Stevie, you know, he was at Wimbledon, I think the Wimbledon Arena, and he just started cussing on stage. He got mad. He got mad and started cussing. And, you know, he was like, fuck this shit. And everybody was just like, it like blew everybody's wig back. Everybody was like, whoa, like Stevie's out here, you know. But I'm like, man, I guess when you get old, you just ain't got time for this.
Yeah.
You ain't got time for this shit no more.
Yeah.
But the fast forward to now where we're at the club. I feel like everything dumb it's like the club is a setting in satire for the,
anything.
Just the dumbest, like, yeah. The levels of ignorance. Like I don't even know how it just gets brought out by just the event of going out to hang out with other people. Mm. It's just like, it's insane. But we're at the club, and I'm actually, it's a jam, it's a bit of a jam session. And
you spoke of Common, just like, yeah, Common, freestyling.
Common, yeah. Just on stage freestyling. At one point I just was like, I wish I had a bullhorn. Just so I could be like, all right, that's enough, goddammit. Like, that motherfucker was freestyling through everything. He was freestyling through the doors opening, closing. It was just like, he was going in. And I was like, bruh, I was like, yeah, okay, Common can rap. We got it. We got it. But it was the funny shit that happened was, you know, Stevie Wonder walks in. I mean, to be honest with you, it's anytime you get a chance to see this dude, you know, and you can still get, I mean, like my mom would say, give a person their roses while they're alive. You know, it's like, you know, give him his due. You know, he's worked real hard in this stuff. And but it was like I was on stage playing, and I mean, I get that this could be a confined space where the stuff, you know, where there's a small stage and all this stuff. But I had this moment, man, that, and I tend to notice things because it's like, not just as a front man, but even when I would be playing beside somebody or playing, you know, in a band or something, I'm always observant of stuff that's happening in the audience. So, I mean, I see Stevie walk in with he has a helper with him. And I was like, oh, cool. You know, it's fine. Mm-hmm. Everything was fine until I looked up in the middle of we were jamming through All I Do. Mm-hmm. I looked up and I was kind of on stage, and I know the stage was small again, like I said, but at one point in the performance, I think Stevie was just facing the wall. Stevie was singing facing the wall. And I got mad. I was like, where the fuck? It's like, y'all just gonna let this happen? Y'all just gonna let it happen? Stevie just facing the wall singing. I was like, really? I'm like, this is really happening.
He's like really putting his back into it.
Yeah, no. He was facing the wall. I think so. I hope somebody, I know somebody turned him around at some point, but it was just the weirdest observation. And in the middle of the song, he started cussing and shit. He started changing the lyrics.
What'd you say? He changed it.
He was saying, what was the chant? He said, oh, he said, keep on talking shit. I'm gonna fuck you up.
Oh my God.
It was just like, oh, Stevie's on the level,
oh
bro.
Oh my God. He's there.
I feel like Stevie carries a pistol.
Super Saiyan Stevie Wonder.
He exists, bro. It was like, I was like, what is it, a full moon? This motherfucker didn't. He didn't trans like Michael. I'm not like other guys. Yeah.
Happy Friday, y'all. Happy Friday to Stevie Wonder only.
Yeah, only. Fuck the rest of y'all.
We'll be back. And we're back. Once again, it's Friday. Man, it's real chill. Like, I feel it in the air, this music. It's like cookout. You know what I mean? Uncle just fell asleep outside and got sunburned. You know, you got
the corona just burned a hole in his thigh.
Yeah, your little cousin grabbing two plates. You know what I mean? He wrapping one in aluminum foil.
Everybody whack mad. Macaroni and cheese.
Yeah. The cops just rolled by, didn't say nothing.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful day. You bowl a lot.
Yeah,
you bowl, man. Like a lot, like more than any.
And I'm not good either.
Musician, yeah, and you're not particularly good. So I'm always like, so is it like catharsis? What is the bowling do? Because ever since we met,
it's just the thing, man. I don't know, man. It's like you know, I always wanted to do it. The funny shit is watching my friends that just pick bowling up and immediately know how to curve the ball.
Yeah.
And I just be like, I'm just trash. Just be like,
you're like, maybe I need a 15-pound ball.
Yeah, like I'm trying to find, like, yeah. I know what it is.
Yeah.
I got to get my own shoes.
Okay, yeah, my ankle, it was ashy today.
I got
so
those two knees.
I need to lubricate my ankles.
One
more
of my knees kind of does this. Like, yeah, no, it's, I just, my average is just really average. I don't know. Everybody, you know, I see everybody. Even my friends on a bad day will get like 150, 175. Yeah. Just kind of stay around 127.
So apart from one story that I have about us bowling, what is there any like memorable moment that you have bowling? Because I know you've done it all over the country and internationally,
man.
Probably. So is there anything that was just like other musicians or anybody else that just you were like, what the fuck is going on?
Man. I think one of the coolest moments, I guess I could say bowling, coolest moments is hanging out with Wiz Khalifa.
Yeah, that's actually what I was going to mention.
Yeah, like he can bowl his ass off, man.
People don't know that.
Yeah, he's a stone cold player with it, man. He got the finesse with everything. He bowls, like, you know, he may get a 300 on you real quick. Yeah. You know, like, you know, he kind of stays above 200.
I remember we went to Penn's.
Yeah.
And I remember that night he was in the lane next to us dressed like a cowboy genie.
Yeah, man.
Just like a Prince backup singer that was also a cowboy. Yeah. That also did magic.
Wiz had the full fit on, bro. Bowling in the full
fit. He was so fly.
Yeah, man. And I'd be like trying to make excuses like I need to take my jewelry off and shit. This motherfucker.
And he's covered.
Covered in jewelry and just getting strikes.
He's wearing pants with like gold buckles going down the side. Like gold,
bro.
Like they look like doubloons or like pirate coins.
Yeah, like pirate money. Yeah, man, it's real shit. And I'd be up there trying to wear shorts and shit. Trying to act like a, you know. But I mean, I love bowling. It kind of started a ways back with me and Austin Peralta. And we always used to, you know, we would sit there and I don't know, it just kind of like vegetate a lot of the time. If it wasn't music, it was just like Big Lebowski.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and we'd argue all the time. We couldn't figure out who was Walter or the dude.
Cause
he just had that real aggressive white boy shit.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, there's no way you could be the dude. You're too aggressive. You're just real aggressive. Like, you wouldn't play jazz that good if you weren't Walter.
Right.
You know, like, but he's like, nah, you're Walter because you're fat. And like, I was like, but I'm black. I was like,
just take that.
I was like, there's no factor. I was like, what is it? Because I'm just an angry black man. Like, so I'm Walter. I was like, I don't get how this correlates. But we would just go back and forth about it. But we always wanted to start a bowling team.
Mm.
You know, it's something that we both kind of just, it was like, that was our kind of a go-to just for like, you know, we'd always threaten to start one. Like, we'd go get shirts made and force our friends to bowl. it was like, yeah, and we never did. We never got a chance to.
Mm-hmm.
And I started bowling a few years back. You know, just I would go on my own.
Mm.
You know, I still do. I still will. And I don't know. It's just something for. It does something for me, I guess. You know. And you know, there was a time. There was a specific time where I would almost bowl every day.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'd be kind of a regular at Penn's over here, down off of Ventura Boulevard.
Mm-hmm.
And I noticed it one day when I walked in and people were calling me by my first name. They just already knew I was gonna get some chicken soup.
You're like, oh shit, I do this too much.
Yeah, like that, you know. And I don't know, it's just kind of stuck with me, man. It's
there's something so therapeutic about frequently doing something that you know you suck at.
Yeah, it's
like let me go fish it. Like,
you never gonna get like in the LA river.
Yeah, like.
You're just catching burnt plastic and styrofoam pieces and shit. May catch a dead child. I don't know. But it's like, yeah, I don't know, man. It's just, it's done something for me throughout the years. It's, you know, it just is always a, makes me feel human a bit.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, in a real way. Not like, I don't know. There's something to it. Like, every now and again, somebody tries to get me into golf. And like, you gotta go golfing. I'm just like, I can't afford to go golfing, bro. Like, that's... I don't feel like I make enough money to go golf. Like, I feel like you gotta have money to golf, bro.
Yeah.
But I don't know, bowling's just always been what it's been. And you know, I don't know, it's what's the best way to describe it? I just like it. I like it. It's fun.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Well,
and I feel good when, you know, it feels good once you, if you go above, you know, what you normally
above
would
shit,
you know.
Yeah, just above like bad.
Yeah.
Anything above bad is good in bowling, I think.
Yeah, man. And just try to have a good time with it.
Well, on that note, I think we're going to listen to some more music, but might go bowling today, you know? Some Black History Month bowling.
Just got to check my bank account.
Yeah.
This governs
literally same.
This will govern like my emotional state for this whole Australian tour.
Oh, yeah. Just go run out of the bowling alley like...
Just go slide into the pins.
Yep. All right, here's more music. I think we're gonna listen to some stuff off of Drank.
Hey,
the Chopped and Screwed version of Drunk.
I feel like that's, to be honest with you, I actually feel like that's the way this album was meant to be heard. Like, I can't even lie. Like, I remember hearing, I heard it a little while ago, And I feel like it's been not almost a year, but maybe a year or so. Mm-hmm. And I remember hearing it, and I just wanting it to be the original,
the actual album.
Yeah. And I'm just like, even with the lyrical content and the stuff that's happening already in the album, mm-hmm. it's this thing where it's like, it just made it better. Mm-hmm. It made it better. Yeah. It did. And it's like, I don't want to listen to the album the normal way anymore. I gotta hear it.
Wow.
I gotta hear it the other way from now on.
That's insane. Well, shit, let's get into it. I think let's do Show You the Way.
Yeah.
Yep. Who was it again? OG Ron. I want to plug his name, right?
DJ Candlestick. Chop Never Slop Food. Big shout out to y'all.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Wow.
Y'all destroyed this.
And we'll be back on Bruh Red Bull Radio. Thank you guys for tuning in. Thundercat's gonna be in Australia. By the time you hear this, he'll be in Australia already.
Yeah.
Playing shows, so get ready for that if you're listening from out there. And I'll catch you next month, last Friday of the month. Same time, same ashy motherfucker, same problem, same issues. Same president, same bullshit. But we're going to keep it rocking in 2018. Goodbye, y'all.
I hate y'all.